Hey everybody, today I am going to be reviewing Fire or Pozar, and this is a short film written and directed by David Lynch. Lynch has been giving us all kinds of treats lately, it seems. He started a YouTube channel during quarantine that is called David Lynch Theater. I'm assuming out of boredom, but I really don't know, and I've learned to just not question his choices. I'm just glad to see him being prolific and creative in any sort of way, or whatever you want to call it, during these times, you know, like giving us weather reports daily and such. He is an oddly compelling man, no matter what he's doing, and you can't say that for a lot of people. Not at all. And here we get another treat, seemingly out of nowhere, similarly to how he just released What Did Jack Do on Netflix a few months back. And here we get another short film that is quite a departure from What Did Jack Do. And it's based on a lot of sketches that David Lynch has drawn. And it is in collaboration with a musician named Marek Zabrowski. And the music is performed by the Penderecki String Quartet. We've been aware of this short film probably since about 2015 when he was talking about it originally, but now it's finally available to the public for free for anybody to watch. I consider myself to be pretty knowledgeable about David Lynch. He's somebody that I've studied a lot. I know his work and I know his philosophy as an artist. And yet this film still surprised me. This is perhaps one of the most surreal, most abstract pieces I think that he's ever done. And with it, he's sort of plunging us into this phantasmagoria fully and giving us a very macabre, a very meditative, very nightmarish, yet hauntingly beautiful piece here that I don't think it matters how you interpret it, and yet it still feels eerily fitting for our current situation in the world. Crazy times of alienation and times of major global crisis. And, you know, I think a lot of that has been the fuel for a lot of creative people and artists that are in lockdown, in quarantine, who have a lot of time on their hands, you know, making art of all that uncertainty and fear and pain, rather than giving into that insanity. And I know we've known about it, like, you know, it's been in the works since 2015, but yet it still feels like a representation of somebody that is making something of their isolation and their depression in a positive way, that uncertainty, but also giving in to that insanity as well. Because I think it's more complex than that. I don't think, you know, you can necessarily channel all of your pain into a, you know, a positive thing. A lot of times it can be complex and quite mixed. Art can save us, but it can also be a reflection of our darkness, bringing that out in abstract ways. So it is a little bit bittersweet. I'm loving the art style here. The illustrations feel almost like a Japanese ghost aesthetic, almost like Japanese folklore in many ways, with the floating spirit figures, the eyes, kind of the Nosferatu hands reaching out. Stylistically, it feels quite primitive in certain ways, very simple, but at the same time, that is what's so powerful about it. It's that simplicity that makes everything from afar look very stark and bold and memorable. The music is incredible here. I think it is the perfect accompaniment to this particular film. I just released a video where I talked about my favorite film scores, and I made a point multiple times throughout the video where I said it's really hard for a composer. The hardest thing is to convey emotions musically for a film without manipulating us in such a way that it is forcing us into a certain direction emotionally. A great score should be complex, where you feel many different things at once, where the intent behind the core of the work is heightened and accentuated, accented by the music, but not exploited for easy sentiment. And this is just everything you could want and more. The music is really dissonant, it's really macabre, and the strings give us that natural feeling, that naturalistic humanity in a way that helps it resonate for us, gives us that melancholy feeling and that connection to the human world, even though it is very surreal and animated. It's also very reminiscent of early 20th century music. It reminds me of a lot of like Stravinsky, particularly like violin concertos. It reminds me of Penderecki, hence the Penderecki String Quartet. Every moment feels really special, really haunting, unnerving, and ultimately moving. And again, it's highlighting what's going on screen without necessarily telling us what we should feel. There's a sequence where you see, it looks like I'm not really sure what it is, but there's a part in the film where you see it looks almost like a meteor shower, or perhaps it could be bombs dropping. It could be a number of things. And as this happens, the music goes into this whole pizzicato section where you hear the strings kind of plucking, giving us these really uneasy textures. It feels grotesque, almost like, yeah, like a nightmare. And that whole idea feeds into, yes, a lot of the imagery and the symbols are open to just a lot of interpretation, because that is inherently David Lynch's philosophy as an artist. And I've discussed that so many times on this channel. Even in the opening of this film, we see a theater, and it looks quite unmistakably like the Club Silencio Theater from Mulholland Drive. And we've seen that reverberate throughout his different works. It's part of his canon, part of the David Lynch world. The Club Silencio scene in Mulholland Drive is one of my favorite scenes of all time in any movie, and I think it is the most important scene in any Lynch film, and the one that illustrates his philosophy the most. The idea that everything he's giving us, every single thing that is on screen from him, is not real. It is art. It is a manipulative illusion, and illusions are, you know, coming from the dreams that we have, and the symbols from the unconscious mind are often masked in abstraction. And that usually is palleted in like this narrative story, usually through books or through cinema, so that we're trying to understand, to make sense of what's going on in the mind. But I think Lynch, he's always so aware of that manipulation, and he's quite adamant about not thinking too much about his work. And that's something I really appreciate about him, is that he never tells us what the intent was with this, or what he feels you should interpret it as, how he interprets it. He lets you just kind of go and let you feel it however you want to. Just like dreams, you don't get any answers from your dreams. You just kind of interpret it based on how it makes you feel. And each person who dreams, you know, if you have a recurring symbol in a dream, it can be interpreted in different ways. Like, you know, for example, you know, say you have water in your dream. It could be, for one person, it could be joy, it could be refreshing, a good thing, like a new beginning. And then to another person who's dreaming about water, it could have this feeling of drowning and feeling stressed and overwhelmed. So it really just depends on your mindset. But at the same time, I think you can learn a lot about the human condition through those dreams. And, you know, often it can be just random images flickering in your mind, and like, you know, all these jumbled narratives that kind of get a jolt every once in a while. All this stuff could mean absolutely nothing, or it could mean everything. And that's what I feel about this film. In a way, it feels like nothing, and at the same time, it feels all-encompassing, and like it captures everything. A lot of the imagery feels almost like mythological. It's, you know, you see at the beginning mankind discovering fire. It's like very primitive sort of thing, almost like a la 2001 A Space Odyssey. It's, you know, they've discovered this tool that can help them rule the world, take over, for better or worse. I think in some ways, or at least I do, I see the film as kind of an examination of humanity and our choices to destroy and hurt ourselves, as well as the natural world. But, you know, eventually it is all going to come to an end, and then the next phase of natural life will begin, or perhaps it could be Mother Nature's triumph over mankind. But a lot of times when I look at the images, I feel as though I'm in this blurry place where nothing is quite concrete in my mind in terms of how I am feeling, in almost like a psychedelic way. You know, you've got the images of, like, you know, you've got the house, and then you've got the tree, and then the sun in between, this blinding fiery thing that is kind of the fuel for us and the tools that we've used to destroy each other and the natural world, our homes and our trees. One of my favorite images in it is that kind of spirit-like thing. I don't know what it is, like a creature of some sort that is floating, and it comes out of the sun, and then the hands are going through the eye holes, and then you see the eyes floating. And for me, I just see all of that very broadly, to be honest with you. I just use how I feel. And for me, I feel a sense of melancholia and pain, dark forces and hatred, whatever it may be, taking over the mind and the soul and destroying purity and simplicity, the simplicity of existence. And though you might see all kinds of interpretations of it, I don't see it as like people bad, nature good sort of thing. It's warped. It's blending together in this surrealistic, dreamlike sort of way. Just emotions blending with symbols and dreams and then making them more complex. Another image that I love is I don't know what you're going to call it, like, I guess like a meteor shower, or it could be a shower of bombs going off, whatever you want to interpret it as, because as it begins, it's just, you have this feeling of fear, of chaos. I feel a sense of peril, danger. But then it appears to be like raindrops. And then all of a sudden you realize that it's tears coming from another figure. That is my favorite part of the film, because it's just this idea, a very simple idea of things dropping and how they can make you feel as the images are shifting. So you have nearly by the end of it, this very grim landscape. It's like an industrial sort of landscape with a floating figure at the very center of it, and the tears are falling and the dark hands are going through. And I don't know, that image is just, it's powerful. It moved me. I'm not sure why it moved me, but it did. It's pain. It's chaos. It's a world growing darker, yet somehow it's all encompassing of one soul, as if one person could represent the world. And just the sadness of that, the eeriness of it, was breathtaking to me. What is so painfully human? And then, of course, at the end, you have, I don't know, like dancing trees, dancing. It's like a mix between trees and elk. I'm really not sure, but I honestly love that. I think it's a powerful way to close the whole thing, because, you know, is it nature triumphing over man, or is it, you know, our minds just kind of slipping deeper into this unconscious state where things are just going crazy, kind of tapping into the gray areas of our perceptions? Or is it, you know, it could just be dancing trees, animals, whatever you want to call it, and that's just what it is, and who cares? I don't really know. And again, I don't think it really matters, because there is no definitive answer. Overall, it feels like a very compelling kind of psychedelic fever dream, very dystopian, and it taps into everything that Lynch stands for. And I don't think you need to spend too much time trying to figure out what this means or that means. You don't really need to take it that literally. It seems to encompass everything that I feel currently, and a lot of people do too. And whether that's literal or not, you know, that's what film does. You know, it's like a projection of what's happening, you know, socially, politically, all of those things. But it is also an illusion to be interpreted. And why so many people connect with art like that, especially film, is because it feels so close to who we are, because we're all human and we all dream. And you must remember, the very important thing about this short is that all of it takes place on a stage. It takes place in a theater, and it is part of the David Lynch world of what illusions are. The whole no hay banda, there is no band. So check this out if you can. It's a really quick watch. It's free on YouTube, so why not? I think you'll likely want to watch it more than once. It completely hypnotized me and drew me in. I loved it. And that is my review. Thank you all for listening. All my social media information is below. You can watch more videos here, and you can subscribe if you'd like. Catch you next time.